So the aim of this talk is to first just make a kind of review of some aspects, some conceptual issues that might arise in quantum gravity, where we take the assumption that maybe, as kind of working hypothesis, maybe space-time as we know it in GR might not be there in some sense. And so the kind of conceptual issues that might arise in this context. And then I'd like to distinguish, because this has been discussed already in the, for some time now by people in this room among others, I'd like to discuss, to distinguish more precisely two kinds of issues, the more epistemic ones and the more ontological ones. Sometimes the distinction between the two is not entirely clear. For instance, this comes under the name of threat of empirical incoherence, this kind of thing. And this distinction has typically come up to my mind with discussion with Nick Huggett in Chicago, among other people. And this work, part of this work, has been done in collaboration with Chris Zittrich. Okay, and then I'll try to elaborate, discuss a little bit with you what I understand is functionalism in this story, and how this kind of functionalist approach tools, conceptual tools, may alleviate, help with these issues. So the aim to identify the conceptual issues, most of you know, related to this notion of emergence of space-time from a level where space-time, the classical space-time in some sense might not be fully there, make this distinction, and then suggest a functionalist strategy. And I'll try to find a little bit what I mean by functionalist there. Might be a little bit different from other understandings of, or precise understanding of functionalism. And also make an analogy with other areas in philosophy of science where functionalist tools have been used, like the philosophy of mind or the debate in the ontology of quantum mechanics. So this is the thing, kind of working hypothesis, that's the idea that it seems from several research programs from gravity that space and time, classical space-time in some sense might not be part of the quantum ontology. This is not necessarily so, but again, it's a possibility. And the idea of this talk is to explore a little bit the conceptual issue that might arise from taking this hypothesis, this possibility seriously. And I'll focus on two sets of conceptual issues. One called empirical incoherence, brought from another context. I'll discuss this a little bit. And the more the ontological one about characterizing the physical ontology without space and time and related issues. So I start with the first one. That's very roughly a little bit the structure of what I understand with this issue of empirical incoherence. It starts with this assumption. It seems that empirical evidence for physical theory always involves somehow physical objects being located in space and time, a pointer pointing somewhere, something, and things like that. More specifically, some people might argue that time, have argued that time and change are required for physical confirmation because it's fundamentally a dynamic process. So we need time and change in some sense in order to make sense for empirical data that we see around us in laboratories and so on. And then the second step is to say that this first step involves that, or implies that empirical evidence, empirical data involves the fundamental, maybe, or the existence of space-time in some sense. So we need space-time in order to make sense of empirical data. That's the idea. And therefore, the conclusion, any theory or framework, theoretical framework denying the fundamental existence, but again, has to be discussed, fundamental existence of space-time, cannot account for what we see around us on empirical data. So it somehow undermines the possibility of being empirically confirmed in the first place. That's a little bit the end here. Of course, from a physics point of view, this is just about the consistency constraints. Okay, any kind of quantum, as people working in quantum gravity, that's a constraint. Any quantum gravity theory somehow should recover the space-time structure of GR in the appropriate regime. That's just a kind of technical issue, and of course non-trivial, but involving approximation limiting procedures, but it's a constraint on theory building there. So we just have to recover the GR. We all know this. But then the question here is that from a more conceptual point of view, whether this is sufficient, not necessary, but whether it's sufficient for the challenge of incoherence to be met. And more precisely, whether we need a notion, a criterion of physical salience. So if we can derive, let's assume that we have a quantum gravity framework, and we can derive mathematically consistently in some sense GR from it, then is it sufficient, okay? Or do we need something more, like criterion of conditional criterion of physical salience for this mathematical derivation of GR from quantum gravity to make sense, to make physical sense? That's the idea here. And another aspect of it is more conceptually, somehow, more ontologically, how can we make sense of possibly known spatiotemporal entities described by this hypothetical quantum gravity framework, non-spatiotemporal entities possibly. How can we make sense of these entities constituting somehow things being located in space and space time features? Seems non-trivial. Seems to be a conceptual issue here on top of it, just physical consistency. Okay, here's an analogy with a debate in the ontology of quantum mechanics. Okay. It's the conception in the ontology, in the debate over the ontology of quantum mechanics, according to which we take the quantum wave function is taken as a real physical entity living on this high-dimensional configuration space and evolving in time. So in this picture, if we take this conception seriously, we don't have, strictly speaking, fundamentally three space. And the challenge here is somehow similar in some sense to account for empirical data. In three space, pointer pointing and so on, this is John Bell's reflections, for instance, out of this picture centered on the way the quantum wave function. And people like David Albert and so on have suggested that we can give it such an account. Typically, he has suggested that the three situation, the ordinary three object in three space, are just encoded in the form of the Hamiltonian, if we choose correctly the coordinatization of the configuration space. And the idea here, the details are not important, the underlying idea is that the quantum wave function on configuration space, this physical field that we take seriously. Welcome to Milo.
Welcome. Thank you.
Snow is beautiful, huh?
It's beautiful out there, yes.
Not very practical, is it? So the idea is pretty clear. It's just to say that somehow this weird object, this weird field living on this high-dimensional space, can somehow play the causal role of what we see around us, of pointers in three objects like pointers pointing and so on, the empirical data in ordinary three objects. That's the idea here. And then people have raised this worry that, okay, possibly you can give me a story, mathematically coherent, how to recover things in three space out of this weird picture. But the question is, how can we know that such mathematical derivation of data in three space in this picture is physically salient? Because we can choose another coordinatization of configuration space where three space is not, configuration space, where three space is not privileged. So it seems that you have to know beforehand that three space is, or object in three space or four dimensional space is somehow physically salient. Again, how do we know that? That's typically Tim Morin's challenge here. Another challenge is, okay, even if all this work, it seems that the quantum wave function is just the wrong entity there. It cannot constitute somehow empirical data. And Alison May, for instance, has written about this, and she gives the argument about the hologram. So the hologram can play the role in some sense, some role of an object is hologram of, but of course it does not constitute the object. So you cannot capture the nature somehow of the empirical data we need to recover. That's the analogy with this debate here. Now the question about the issue about the physical ontology without the characterization of the physical ontology without space-time, there are two aspects to this ontological question. First, the first aspect is how to characterize the fact that you have many objects, a plurality of conical objects, possibly at the conical level in this non-spatial-temporal context. That's a possible question we could ask. Another one, I'll rather focus on this one, is what makes such an ontology, possible ontology described by quantum gravity without space-time, physical in contrast to an ontology of, I don't know, mathematical objects, for instance. Okay? What extent are these objects described by quantum gravity physical and not merely mathematical, like numbers and so on? Typically, the criterion for such a distinction between physical and mathematical have been space-time and causation. Okay? Concrete physical entities are in space-time, or some of them have space-time features, whereas abstract mathematical ones are not in space-time. Clearly, in this quantum gravity context, it's not appropriate as a criterion for concreteness. The other standard one is causation. Concrete physical entities, as opposed to abstract mathematical ones, are considered to be causally efficacious in some sense. But of course, in this context, in this quantum gravity context, it requires a notion of non-spatial temporal causation. Again, assuming that the fundamental level described by quantum gravity is non-spatial temporal in some sense. And the idea here, the strategy is to combine these two, in some sense, these two standard criteria. Okay? The strategy here, we call functionalists, is to focus on the space-time functions, the functions played by space-time, the spatio-temporal space-time-like roles in some role sense, not necessarily causal, that the fundamental quantum gravity entities or the entities described by quantum gravity may instantiate. Okay? The roles played by these entities described by the quantum gravity theoretical frameworks. And here, the idea is to focus on the roles played by space-time in accounting for empirical evidence in various theoretical contexts, with UTR and so on, rather than on these notion of constitution or composition, or the nature of threesome and so on. And this shift in focus on the roles played, the relevant roles played by space-time, this may alleviate some of the conceptual worries I've just mentioned. I'll try to just sketch a little bit how this might be so. Just before that, analogy with if you talk about functionalism to a philosopher of science, directly ring a bell about the debate with philosopher of mind, where mental states, because this is the normal variable question, the relationship between the mind and body, mental states and brain states. And one strategy here, one functional strategy which has been developed is just to understand mental states in terms of their functional roles, okay, the mental states like being in pain, and understood in terms of their relations to sensory inputs, other mental states, and behavioral outputs. And these roles can be dissociated by an ontology by brain states. Okay? This is one way to understand the relationship between mental states and brain states. Typically, being in pain, very roughly, can be understood as a property of an animal that is caused by damage to its tissues and cause different behavior and so on. Okay, but the idea here, of course, then there are a huge amount of literature of how exactly to understand this and what's the implication, what's the metaphysics behind it, and so on. I'm not interested in this. The idea here really is the focusing on the function is on the function realized by possibly by the brain states, rather than on the constitution of the mental states. What's the constitution? What's the constitution of mental states? That's the idea. And here I think there is a similarity with the case of space-time. So functionalism about space-time in this understanding is the idea that space-time can be functionally characterized in terms of its roles in physical theories. It's well described by physical theories, like GR, for instance, and these functions may be executed, realized, not by relativity space-time, but rather by an ontology described by quantum gravity, by this more fundamental ontology described by the quantum gravity framework. And the idea here is that space-time, relativistic space-time may not be fully recovered, merged in some strong ontological sense, because there is all this debate about ontological emergence and so on. To provide a ground for empirical evidence, because this is the aim, remember, okay, to give an account of how it makes sense of empirical data in free space in this context. What we need from this point of view, it's only the relevant space and features relevant for empirical information, for empirical data. And this, of course, allows for deviations, like the notion of its own locality in certain contexts, and of course, for new predictions, therefore. Okay, that's the strategy here. In the slogan form, this is Chris putting a slogan, it's space-time is as space-time does. There's nothing beyond that. No question about its nature and so on, from this point of view. And it's enough for resolving, addressing some of the conceptual issues I've mentioned. There are several ways to understand then the details of this strategy. Here's one typical standard way in the philosophy of mind literature to understand the relationship between a higher level and a lower level. Call it reduction or emergence, and whether it's reduction or emergence, I think Michael Stab will talk about this tomorrow. It's not very interesting to me because I don't see necessarily a tension between the two notions here. Whether we call it functional reduction of space-time to quantum gravity level or emergence, this is not necessarily relevant here. Here is an example. So you consider the first step, you consider higher level properties, space-time properties, to be functionalized. That is, they are given a functional definition in terms of their role, described by the roles of your theory and so on. And then you give an explanation how the lower level properties can just realize these functional role. Okay? This is typically Kim in philosophy of mind or philosophy of special sciences has elaborated this kind of strategy for understanding the relationship between these levels. And a nice feature, I'm going to talk about a little bit more about this, is that different lower level properties, for instance, at the quantum gravity level, can play the same functional space-time role. Okay? It's called in the philosophy literature, it's called multiple relativity. Typically, there's an analogy in the physics literature with the notion of universality. And this is, I think, a nice feature of this understanding. In the space-time case, we look something like that. The relevant space-time properties, in particular, the properties, space-time properties relevant for empirical confirmation, like localization again, maybe, need to be understood in terms of their functional role. Okay? Of course, that's the first step. Of course, then, we can have an interesting debate about what exactly the functional role of space-time, what are the relevant feature of space-time which need to be functionalized. There is work to be done here. For instance, Bouchard, I think, might talk a little bit about this. And then in the second step, of course, we need to provide an explanation of how the entity described by quantum gravity can feel this functional world. And typically, here the philosopher will rely on the work of physicists giving us a story about how this relationship, how this feeling the walls might be in the different quantum gravity frameworks. Let's just give a very rough, brief example of how this might work about localization typically. Remember that this very common view about the state of empirical incoherence crucially relies on the fact that empirical evidence involves somehow special temporal localization. The pointer has to be somewhere in order for us to have empirical data. But here, if we take the view that it's a phenomenal consequence, as several quantum gravity programs take, that there is no external fixed physical background with respect to which physical systems are localized, then it seems, in this functionalist perspective, that localization is not inherently spatiotemporal, in the sense that not only with respect to a space-time background, but rather, again, from this functionalist perspective, from the dynamical, in the sense of respect to other dynamical systems. Okay? If you take this perspective, it seems that then geolocalization already at the GL classical level can be somehow functionally understood in terms of the right functional relationships between physical fields. Here is an example of this construction of like agent part localization in GR as again understood as functional relations between among dynamical entities. This was this would amount somehow to this first step, okay, the functional reduction of emergence, the first step of the functional definition. Here I give an example where you can localize a physical tensor field with respect to, I don't know, Maxwell field, in some respects to four independent scalar fields. For instance, here I give the example of the Bergmann functionals of the metric field, the Bayes scalars, for instance. And here, these fields, okay, play the kind of right sort of localization function for space-time points. Okay? You don't need to talk about space-time points there. They give you physical coordinates in a charged independent way for your space-time, provided that you don't have too many symmetries and so on, of course. But this is just an example, okay? It might be very contrived, very complicated to construct this, to build these bag scalars and so on, but it just gives you a flavor of how this functional perspective on localization might work. Here we can, again, we can conceive this, not as being about things being located in space-time, but as for our naive understanding of empirical data and empirical information, but rather as the right sort of functional relations among dynamical entities being fulfilled, realized. Just the idea. So here the localization function can be realized in different ways within GR, in the sense of with respect to different dynamical entities. We can choose different scalar fields, for instance, all of the things. Just a side note here. There is a potentially interesting link between three notions here. You know, an understanding of relationalism, understood as in the sense of the position of about the nature of space-time being about relations among about material entities, rather than a substantial thing, distinct, ontologically distinct of matter. Structuralism, in the sense that physical entities are best characterized in relational terms rather than in terms of intrinsic properties. There's no dislink there. And the kind of functionalist story I've tried to sketch here. The kind of convergence of different views in philosophy or metaphysics about space-time, about the nature of objects, and about understanding relationships between different levels. Might be interesting here. Okay, of course, hard work now to show in concrete cases how quantum gravity entities can play the right sort of functional roles. And again, here, the job of the philosopher, I think, is just to look at concrete quantum gravity programs and to see what's the story they can give us in order for this second step to be satisfied. Remember, that's about how the quantum gravity entities can fill the right sort of functional roles for us to make sense of empirical data. We have a paper on this with Chris, and I'm not going to go into details about this, but we will discuss the story given by causal set theory, and a little bit also the story in the canonical gravity, new quantum gravity, for instance. A nice feature, as I mentioned before, is that we can have, it seems, different quantum gravity entities playing the same functional high-level space-time role. And this is entirely natural from Fanconi's point of view. Okay? Remember why? Because at the higher level, at the space-time level, for instance, or at the in the analogy of the philosophy of mind at the mental state level, we can define the functional role, and then at the lower level, there might be several different entities playing the same high-level functional role here, the same space-time role. I think Erasmus is going to talk a little bit about this, and this might be a nice feature here, this kind of polyploid versatility, or
yeah,
this flexibility, let's say, of this kind of framework. Because again, why? Because we might have a different quantum gravity entity described by quantum gravity playing the same functional space-time role at a higher level, at the level of GR, for instance. This is a nice feature of this kind of perspective. You just give a very naive example of the semi-classical spinet, which is so-called wave states. You can have the same similar story with coherent states, playing the kind of average metrical role. You have the area and volume operator, applied to this rights of network states, having almost classical eigenvalues. That's a little bit the idea. Of course, we can have different spin network states playing this role. And of course, this is to be expected, okay? Where space-time features are functionally realized through the collective dynamics of quantum gravity degrees of freedom. This is typically something that you can find in a group field theory, these kind of approaches as well, where there is a strong analogy with thermodynamical features, okay? A given thermodynamical feature can be realized by, of course, different configurations. But then, and this is, I think, Nick, I guess, raised this point to me and to us, that you might question to what extent this is a genuine case of multiple relativity, because remember, in the case of philosophy of mind, the story was about same brain state, like Zygmunt Pain, being brain state type, sorry, being realized by in radically different ways by different organisms, for instance. And here it's not clear that we have such a genuine case of multiple relativity. In thermodynamics, for instance, few people maybe would say we have a case of multiple relativity, and here, to some extent, it's obvious. But still, this is about the philosophical debate. Still, I think this flexibility of this kind of framework is interesting. Okay. And then, question of analogens of empirical data. Recall the threat of empirical incoherence, no space-time, no empirical evidence. It seems that any way of empirical justifying our theory is undermined. From the flexional functions perspective, no worry. Why? Because all that is required for empirical justification is that the quantum gravity entities play the right sort of functional role. Okay? Typically, the right sort in the sense of the role of empirical data located in space-time. What looks like empirical data located in vertical space-time and their proper fields. And from this point of view, and this is for Baptiste, there is no space-time qualia. Okay? Qualia is a technical term in the philosophy of mind for this kind of phenomenological a feature that is not captured by this functional story of the relationship between mental states and brain states. Okay? So no hard problem here. But Baptiste will be otherwise, I guess, in his talk. Okay, remember the challenge of physical salience. Here, this is also something Nick Haggett raised in his comments. Kind of epistemic skepticism that we can have. To what extent are we justified in believing that in believing in normal space-time quantum gravity entities beyond or independently of the space-time world? It seems that the only way to know about these quantum gravity entities is in terms of the space-time world. So, how can we be justified in going beyond their space-time world, since that's all we can have access to? Or in other terms, another way to put it is that the justification ultimately seems spatiotemporal, the justification for physical salience, okay, of the mathematical derivation in quantum gravity. So in other terms, again, the conditions for physical salience seem ultimately spatiotemporal, irreducibly spatiotemporal. And an obvious reply is just to say, a new theoretical framework like quantum gravity can provide its own conditions for physical salience. Okay? It's not like physical. It's not like we have predefined conditions of physical salience given once and for all, and then we just have to live with this. No, a new theoretical framework can provide new conditions, and I think typically the work of this has been also. Or will be, or has been elaborated by Nick and Chris in their work. And the good thing here, and this is something I want to emphasize in this talk, is that the functions perspective advocated here also has a kind of epistemic interesting feature in the sense that it ensures that the standard epistemological discussion can just proceed. Then you can advocate a standard scientific realist perspective quantum gravity, or you can be instrumentalist in the theory. This is the standard debate. But the functionalist perspective just ensures that there is nothing specific about classical space time not being there for these epistemic debates. And typically, the scientific realist can just have the normal stance of committing herself to the central quantum gravity entities. And this is important, crucial for novel empirically successful predictions. To the extent that we have empirically successful predictions in quantum gravity, then the standard scientific strategy, scientific realist strategy, just applies, I think, in this functionalist perspective. Nothing special there. The challenge of constitution, remember, the idea was the challenge was that it seemed that functionalism somehow cannot account for how something spatial-temporal can, non-spatial-temporal can constitute things with space-time features. In a similar way, it's not clear how a hologram can constitute an object with a hologram. It's not clear how brain states can constitute mental states, different nature. Something is not captured by the functional roles. The functional roles do not exhaust the nature of this opposition. But of course here, the stance is just to say that, first of all, the notion of spatial-temporal constitution involved sometimes in these debates is not adequate in this context. Okay? Kind of golden box heuristics sometimes in the quantum gravity literature. And it's maybe not intuitive, but perfectly coherent here to have the position that nothing about relevant smooth space-time features beyond their functional role out there. There's nothing else. Again. It's just the space-time is as space-time does. There is nothing incoherent to saying that there is nothing beyond these functional roles. That's the obvious reply. So no constitution problem. It's just because you have a wrong attitude with respect to the theory. And finally, the more ontological question about what makes such an ontology without space-time as described by quantum gravity physical, okay, outside space-time or without space-time, in contrast to an ontology of abstract, fully abstract mathematical entities. And here, I think an interesting possible move for the functionalist in this sense is to say that the structures, the entities described by quantum gravity are concrete, physical, as opposed to abstract mathematical entities, in virtue of the space-time roles, precisely, that you can play in certain circumstances. This is crucial here. So in this sense, it's a combination of the standard strategies, of the standard criteria that we have seen for concreteness versus abstract things. There might be a worry in certain quantum gravity programs where we might have phase, non-geometrical phases, for instance, where entities are not directly linked to space-time functions. But again, it seems that in order to be considered as concrete, again, as opposed to pi or purely mathematical entity, it seems that somehow the quantum, the entity is described by this quantum gravity level, that somehow relates to some extent to the ones playing the right sort of space and walls for accounting for people there. Okay? Typically through some kind of phase transition or something, but there must be a relation. Otherwise, the very distinction between abstract, between concrete and abstract, there is out here at mind. Okay, close with this. Just summary. Just wanted to show you a different kind of conceptual issues in quantum gravity, the more ontological issues about characterizing the fundamental level without space and time, the constitution question, and there are more epistemic aspects to the issues, like it's kind of epistemic skepticism that one might have. And then I've tried to argue that a broad functionalist perspective, in the sense I've mentioned, I've defined, might help to address these issues. For instance, question about the emergence in functionalist terms, and the epistemic relevance of the functionalist strategy advocated here. That's all. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Please.
So,
Can you maybe sort of briefly summarize what is your response to the space-time identity theorist? So we, maybe the identity theorist could say that the functions you identified are just properties of the special kind that space-time is. So what is it that suggests to you that we should be functionists and not space-time identity theorists?
I think it's more flexible as a framework. I think you can massage some more kind of identity theory. This is for people who are learning the framework, but you don't need to, and here at least it allows you to have more freedom for more flexibility again.
So the suggestion would be to say functionalism is not incoherent and it's more flexible. So
yes.
It's sort of just offering the position.
Yeah, it offers all you need.
Yeah.
Without too heavy metaphysical cost.
So there's an aspect of metaphysical cost in the
Yes,
true.
Yeah. And by the way, in this system, the debate we have with Christopher, we think that then many issues or questions just dissolve if you take this kind of perspective. And maybe that's the take-home message.
That makes it desirable somehow.
Yes.
I mean, I'll say a tiny bit about this in my talk, but I think there's another response to that, which is I think that not all of the analogies between the debate and mind go through here, because I think space-time is a theoretical term, and in the debate and philosophy of mind, you rely on the fact that you have kind of ways to establish reference to different kinds of states to establish the identity, and it's just not clear that that's the way the debate proceeds when you're talking about something that's as robustly a theoretical term. If you think that's, I don't think you can make sort of ostensive reference to space-time. Right, so some of the positions like identity theory, I think, aren't easy to cash out in the same way that they do in the philosophy of mind. I think you can.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a real sense in which you can think of functionalism as the only game of town because of the nature of the theoretical term in a way that's different from the philosophy of mind. That's what that's something.
But again, I think our framework is not committed to taking space time only as a theoretical term. You have more robust to view of space time and still holding this kind of view.
To follow up on that, I agree with you that I think the framework that we're proposing for quantum gravity is certainly also consistent with the assumption that space-time is not a theoretical term, but space-time is a concrete physical thing, or a concrete thing, I should say, maybe without committing to physical, like pain or anything like that. It's at least possible. Maybe that's the wrong thing.
Connection is a theoretical term, but it's a physical thing. But so that's not a contrast. But I mean, but anyway, I think we may be using different phrases of theoretical term here. I don't mean that it can't be a thing.
Okay.
It's about how we establish reference to it.
Yeah.
Okay, I see. it may be a theoretical term, it may be a term in common language that we refer to as we do to other everyday objects. I don't think that anything necessarily, or both possibilities should be able to be accommodated in that picture. Having said that, of course, it may be a mistake to think of space-time as along the same line as pain, or as referring in the same way as pain does. So that's just to support what you said, I guess.
Yeah, I'd also like to talk about what you said. I think really the difference boils down to what you think of functions about, but you use it in order to pick out entities in the world. So as in the philosophy of mind, this is the reference-fixing type of functionalism, as opposed to essence or analytic functionalism, which characterizes the entity in question by its functional role as its nominal essence, and that's what it boils down to. So if you use functionalism as a reference-fixing device, then it's a semantic tool to pick out reference, and you are neutral or silent, depending on where you're standing on the metaphysically more juicy questions, like what's the right category, what's the nature of this being on the state.
I think that's a little bit our attitude there. We're more Swiss, we like the mortality.
but I also have kind of party pooper question. what's here in this quantum gravity community, what's so special about quantum gravity in this particular context? What I have in mind is there anything you couldn't say if you look at more the non-quantum projects of, let's say, reducing GR or special relativity? If you think of special relativity, what about Rob's eliminativist program to reduce special relativity's space-time to, well, causal notions? It's not really causal quantum. I mean, these are irreducibly spatiotemporal, but it's a reductionist program, and I think you say a lot of the things you said here for quantum gravity, you could just as well say about Rob's causal program. And so I'm interested, what's so special about quantum gravity in this context?
I think you're right. I think the function strategy advocated here is very versatile or flexible,
yes.
So it can be accommodated in different frameworks, clearly. And as the example I've given, those of mine in the debate about the idea of quantum event, maybe Rob's framework as well. But the thing here is, I think there are specificities to the quantum gravity case, which are best dealt with taking a structuralist perspective. In other contexts, maybe I'm thinking about the debate in non-quantum mechanics. It's one possible option, interesting option, like taking the wave function as a physical entity and then having this kind of functional story. But it's not the only one, and the arguments in favor of other ones, like intuitiveness and so on. But here, I think that's the possibilities are much more restricted somehow, and functionalism comes out as a kind of natural perspective or strategy in this specific quantum gravity context. That
I'm bored with everything you say about quantum gravity. I'm just interested in what makes quantum gravity such a particularly interesting case, and is it just because quantum gravity is so kind of complicated and
yes.
complex so that we have no other answers to it?
Thanks for trying to answer a more precisely your question. So I think what is specific about quantum gravity is the lack of genuine alternatives. That would be the easy, the most direct answer. That's the most natural way of understanding the relationship between classical smooth space-time, as described by GR, and possibly different non-spatial-temporal ontologies described by quantum gravity frameworks.
But lack of alternatives, why should this not apply to, let's say, Rob's program? Because it, in a sense, Rob's program is possibly the only fully worked out fundamental alternative to special relativity.
Again, a lack of alternative as a conceptual perspective, I take the functionist perspective as being the most natural one to take in the quantum gravity context. That's the
I would think the functionalist program is usually strengthened by the fact that it's actually a really good way to think about classical theories as well. Mm. And then the fact that it can also accommodate quantum gravity is a massive strength. It's not that it has to have something, it's not that it has to be better in the case of quantum, in the case of quantum gravity than classical theories. You're better off if it's a great way of thinking about classical theories too. And then it so happens that actually you can accommodate quantum gravity in the same framework. You might have wanted to think about classical theories. If your arguments go through, right? I mean, it doesn't seem like it's an argument against space-time functionalism that's going to
work
really
sure.
in non-quantum context.
But I would say I have the opposite attitude in some sense, saying that I'm interested in the problem in quantum gravity, and I take the kind of functional strategy to be the most obvious one. And then I see that there are other people in different areas advocating similar tools. And there may be the alternatives, but these tools also make sense there, and so it seems like kind of all things is building. That's all the way I approach it. It's not like I want to advocate a functionalism about everything, and then I look at the different areas of physics and all that. It's not.
Okay, then maybe the reason why I think it would be very interesting to have a look at this comparison between functionalism in quantum gravity as opposed to functionalism in Rob's program would be that in Rob's program we can pretty well identify the nature of the fundamental constituents as genuinely irreducibly spatial temporal, whereas in quantum gravity we just don't have any clue whatsoever what these things are in any shape.
So you take it as an excellent case study? Or
yeah, to have this comparison, functionalism and quantum gravity as opposed to functionalism in box programming.
Yeah, good point. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry, Chris.
I think this is precisely the question where I think the Oxford attitude and the Geneva attitude are sort of like complementary a little bit to one another. If you're coming more from the Oxford side of things, then you ask precisely that question. You think like, so what's the big deal about space-time function? We've been advocating something like that all along. That's naturally the right way to think about it, and it has been going back to Rob or etc. etc. If you look at it from Geneva, as you said, to drive that point home a little bit more strongly, even it's that you think, okay, the dynamical approach or functionalist approach to special relativity or general relativity may be an attractive interpretive option at that level, but it's not the only game in town. You have a geometric approach, you may have other approaches which are more realist about space-time or somehow different, and there seems to be a genuine debate. In quantum gravity, and this I think is where we're coming from, is it seems like these things are not spatio-temporal, so in a sense you don't have the alternative anymore. It's almost as if the geometrical approach, or maybe that's not the right word, but an approach too closely tied to a sort of a strong form of space-time realism is not available there anymore. Whereas, as opposed to Rob, you could just say, well, what's the problem with you, Rob? I'm a realist about Minkowski's space-time, and that's that. That you can reconstruct that's a nice mathematical game you're playing, but it really has no metaphysical significance. And I think in quantum gravity, this is where we're coming from, we'd be like, you have to do something. You don't have any of these alternatives anymore. So I don't know, that hopefully addresses it a little bit. So it's like, that's the sense in which there's no alternative. You said you're leading the discussion, right? Yeah.
I mean, obviously, I could just keep talking to Shania. I completely see that, and I think you're right that the quantum gravity case pushes the case really forcefully. I just think the strategies are genuinely complementary, and you're kind of denying yourself an advantage of your position, right? If you don't think the classical, because one of the arguments in the classical case is, yeah, you could be a subject, you can have these debates, but to some extent, properly conceived, perhaps there are debates about what functional roles you think space-time plays and what accentuates functional roles in classical theories anyway. And so I think maybe there's a more powerful way of seeing this as quantum gravity is less discontinuous with the tradition, which I think is quite a powerful argument for skeptical philosophy. It goes along in the same way that your and Nick Huggett's work helps one to see that this isn't, that really the right way that we should think about empirical coherence has quantum gravity being continuous in certain senses and empirical coherence of previous theories. I think the same kind of strategy evolves here, so you can get your kind of Tim Wardle and skeptical philosophers slightly more on side by saying, look, this was the right way to think about theories anyway, this is actually the right way to theorise. So I think overdoing the contrast between the two approaches, I think, might deny you a tool for arguing for your approach.
I really meant to say complementary in a way. Yeah. It's a different sort of perspective. But
yeah. No, I think it's certainly coming up from two angles.
There is an argument for some kind of continuity between the right sort of perspective with respect to the classical theory, and then the obvious perspective with respect to the function.
And ultimately, if we're right, these classical theories are true by virtue of the things that are true. So if you think of it, by virtue of instantiating some kind of quantum gravity anyway,
That's a little bit what I've tried to hint at also from a different perspective without mentioning the dynamical approach, in the sense of this kind of relationship between at the classical level, really between this kind of functionist perspective that we might have, the relationalist point of view about space time, and possibly suppress whatever that means. It was a brief comment on that. That's a little bit into some action. There is a continuity there, yes. But this person,
yes, I'm going to go to the juicy part of the world. I was just thinking about what you call epistemic skepticism, and I think that here there is an interesting connection between the kind of functionalism you endorse and the nature of the skeptic challenge that you get. And the reason is that if you have a form of functionalism which is role functionalism, the more ontological functionalism, second order properties functionalism, with multi-realizability, then since from the realized structure, you cannot be sure that there is only one fundamental structure able to realize this structure. So you have a harder skeptic challenge. Is that exactly how you put it? Because you said that to what extent are we justified believing in non-spatial temporal future entities beyond the role? But here it's even how can we know about the nature, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that this form of ontological functionalism triggers a kind of skeptic challenge. When if you have a more if you have a weaker form of functionalism, what we call analytic functionalism or linguistic functionalism, coupled, for instance, with an identity theory of the reference terms or eliminativism about space-time, you don't really have a skeptic challenge like
mm-hmm.
this. So I just wanted to point out that depending on the functionalism
yes.
that you select, you will have different epistemological principles.
I see that, but this is, I see, thank you. It's helpful. But I think you have the kind of metaphysical, you have the metaphysician reading of this kind of worries. It was just more more obvious in some sense. Just a stand-up, I don't know, physicist, I don't know, just looking at these things and saying, or the quantum gravity modeling, for instance, just looking at these things and, yeah, okay. Fair enough, but the only way to make sense of these entities are is in terms of their function roles. So how can I be justified to believe in things beyond their function roles? Because the only way to justify them is in terms of their function roles. Kind of circles there, epistemic circle.
I agree. It's
but then we can reread this from the kind of more metaphysical.
So by the way, from of course, it's a metaphysics point of view, but mainly to physical consequences, because it can lead to a form of the idea that we may not access to the fundamental ontology.
Yeah, no, okay. But again, from a purely physicist point of view, without knowing all these philosophical debates about functionalism, just look at this and can have this kind of skeptic instrumentalist attitude with respect to this kind of things. This was a little bit too dry.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, please.
I also have another question on about the realizability issue. I'd like to push it a bit against the analogy between philosophy of mind and what we seem to have in quantum gravity. Because much of the realizability, I think, in the philosophy of mind is really about possible realizations in one and the same logically possible world. Whereas the kind of multi-realizability that we seem to be talking about in this context, in quantum gravity context, is really different possible worlds with different laws. So where we can realize, we have different worlds in which different laws apply, and these different laws then pick out different spatial-temporal structures.
Yeah, this is
and this seems to be a very important disanalogy,
yes,
I would say.
Right. This is one way, but I think there's also a different, weaker sense of logical realizability, even without it invoking morality in one world, namely, I don't know, different ways. The localization function can be instantiated in the same space and the same world by different quantum gravity entities playing the rights of functional localization role in the same world.
No, I mean, sure, there's some similarities. I just think it might be worth
mulling
over.
Yeah.
What is the disanalogy mean in this context?
Yeah. But even for the debate in quantum. Quantum case and the philosophy of mind, there are disanalogies, clearly. It's just that I think it's interesting to look at the philosophical roots of this kind of strategy and how they are being used there to solve what kind of problems
mm-hmm.
and see then how far we can go in quantum gravity context, bearing in mind the disanalogies, obviously. Please.
this is another thing I wanted to comment on, because I mean, I think this is one place where linking up with, now admittedly the terminology here is a bit of a mess, but linking up with the literature on production and emergence more generally in physics would be really useful, because you know, universality, multiple realizability are kind of messy terms that people have tried to precisify them in various kinds of ways, and there are clearly a whole bunch of distinctions you can make. One thing is whether there's a distinction between robustness under perturbations of the underlying physics and something like a sort of more robustly defined universality, which seems rather different from multiple realizability in the philosophy of mind. So this, I think in this case, the analogies are probably better served with other physics examples where people have tried to work out these concepts quite a lot. Admittedly, I mean, one of my frustrations about literature, I go and try to disentangle it in my own ways in various books, but one of my frustrations about literature is that people are muddled about terminology too. But I think maybe the right place to look for analogies to do justice to your point is the literature, a kind of, you know, the literature that stands out better than on Locke Bannerman's stuff is very clear, but there's a literature stemming out of that thinking about things like robustness under perturbations contrasted with genuine physics multiple realizability, which means something perhaps akin to but slightly different.
Again, the strategy here is not linked to there being multiple realizability in the philosophy of mind sense. No, you're fully right, and Karen has done some work on modestness and so on. We discussed we discussed a little bit this in our manuscript and in the small book with Daniele about robustness universality, because in the condensed matter approach or the field theory approach, we talk about this. Of course, we have these notions there, and whether or not there are cases of multiple realizability as philosopher of mind understanding. No, but the important point for us is that this kind of robustness, universality, and so on are well accounted for in this kind of structure and functions perspective. That's the
Dr. Lam, you forgot my question.
Sorry.
Is this a Freudian phenomenon or something?
No,
I wanted to ask you about your examples of local. I think it was a functional rule, was localization.
Yes.
So I didn't understand the background with the examples, but my question was, is the functional rule played here one of the coordinates of space-time? It's not the same. It's this.
They are called pseudo coordinates. It's not a coordinate. It's a kind of physical coordinate.
Yes, but they play
the
physical fields play the role of the coordinates.
Yes.
Right. So this is an example which is a functional role of the coordinates, not a functional role of space time.
No. It's a functional role of localization. And in order to localize things, you need the coordinates.
Yeah, sure. But that's an example of what the coordinates do.
Yes.
Which seems easy. Now I can explain. Okay, what coordinates do? But this is very, very far from explaining what space time.
Yeah, sure, but it's an example. But without space time, it's more complicated to explain what coordinates do.
No, clearly coordinates depend on the existence of space time and the geometrical structure and everything. But you know, it's an easy example once you have that to explain what coordinates do. Well,
sure.
You know, anything which is one-to-one map and which preserves some of the structure is playing the role of coordinates.
Yes.
It's easy to explain. I think the real problem is that if you want to do something with this, you need to explain what a functional rule is, and then you need to give explain what the functional rule is actually. Which are them? Point to them, right?
I'll just take the example of manifold points being used for localization, and then you can use coordinates and so on, a chart and so on, and you can redefine this in terms of relations among dynamical entities or functionals of the metric typically without using the manifold point. That's all. And the role of the manifold point is played by these relations among these entities. That's all. It's an easy example, I agree, but it's just to give a flavor of how it might work. That's the idea.
So now that the chairman has stepped out, is the problem that we don't have the coffee yet?
Yeah.
Okay, so if we don't have the coffee yet, we might as well go on with one or more two questions, right? Is that agreed? Or
people might want to stretch their legs a bit.
Okay, is there an urgent question?
Knowing that there is no coffee outside.
Well,
Thank you.
There is one urgent question.
No, it's not urgent. It was only, it's only in the spirit of keep talking.
So should we then thank Vesa again? So I don't know what happened to the coffee, whether it got stuck in the snow as well.